Someday you'll thank me for this. The Official Southern Lady's Guide to Being a Perfect Mother. By Gayden Metcalfe and Charlotte Hayes. Narrated by Marguerite Gavin. Copyright 2009 by Gayden Metcalfe and Charlotte Hayes. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Hyperion and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Chapter 1. The Southern Mother's Rules for Life. You might be a Southern mother if you took the initiative to help pick your daughter's husband, silver pattern, nanny, honeymoon destination, and even the flowers in the table decorations at her birth. You know the route and schedule of every soccer, ballet, fencing, karate mom in the PTA. You think cheerleading is an honorable major for your daughter at the University of Mississippi, though you feel a double major in Mrs. is best. You have an enormous library of small-format videotapes documenting your child's every move since your first sonogram. If you are a Southern grandmother, you worry that Precious will see the sonogram picture and figure out that it wasn't the stork that brought the baby. You know the proper technique for hanging and dressing venison. You actually shot the deer yourself. You have helped your daughter cram for the all-important exam for her Mrs. degree. Some people call their exams finals. The Mrs.-seeking student calls them vows. Your hunting dogs have better manners than your children, and cost a lot more, too. You participate in a county-wide exchange program for domestic help when holidays and birthdays come around. You straighten up the house prior to your housekeeper's arrival for fear she will quit if she sees how things really get some days. Your cell number is on your daughter's teacher's speed dial. You believe it's better to get an A in deportment than in French. You keep a discreet stash of sedatives for the days when report cards come home. You have made generous donations to the Alumni Association at your school to ensure your daughter's acceptance. You run into a friend and the first words out of your mouth are, "How's your mother?" Hugh Dixon Gayden Miller, a Southern nephew, who is also the son of a Southern mother, compiled this list. Southern society is arranged along matriarchal lines. The Southern matriarch is a far more formidable creature than the much nicer Southern male. She has to be this way. She has no choice. She was put on earth with a sacred mission to drum good manners and the proper religion, ancestor worship, into the next generation. Whenever a Southerner sees a man seated while ladies remain standing, she thinks, "I know what kind of mama he had." Mama is well aware that, should she fail, total strangers will someday condemn her with these very words. She reminds us of this frequently. While Daddy can spoil and dote on his precious little baby darling, whom he still calls precious baby girl long after she qualifies for Social Security, it is Mother's duty to turn Precious into a lady, and Trey, for the third, into a gentleman. The words lady and gentleman do not connote mere gender to a Southerner. They do not mean male and female. He created them. They mean lady and gentleman. She created them. The words lady and gentleman enshrine a chivalric ideal which mother must uphold and preserve, even if it kills her and us. Look on the bright side. This ensures a future income for members of the mental health profession. To achieve her ends, the Southern mother practices shock and awe parenthood. She is shocking in her demands and awesome in her subtlety. She speaks in code, the nice code. In the hands of a practiced Southern mother, being nice is lethal. Her children and associates often feel that they are being stoned to death by popcorn. Machiavelli could have taken lessons from the Southern mother. She has perfected the art of diplomatic doublespeak. "Aren't you chilly tonight?" is not Mother's update from the Weather Channel. What she really means is, "You look like a floozy. Go upstairs and change right this very minute." If a Northern mother says, "My, it's humid tonight," what she is trying to say is, "My, it's humid tonight." When a Southern mother makes this seemingly innocent statement, what she means is, haven't you ever heard of cream rinse? Your hair's frizzier than a grizzly bear's. Beware of the Southern mother who purrs, it's a beautiful afternoon, why don't you take a walk? Translation, you are fatter than Buddy Boy Jones's 4-H pig. Nor is, you look so pretty with your hair up, as kind as it might sound to the outsider. It actually means, get that ugly thicket off your face. When a Southern daughter has a hot date, mother will likely present her cheek for a farewell peck. This is not because mother is starved for affection. She is testing for halitosis. We have a friend who was not blessed with a Southern mother, but she acquired a Southern mother-in-law. She should have gone to Southern Berlitz school before joining the family. When she and her mother-in-law went shopping together, she was actually pleased whenever Mrs. Nelson Sr. said, "That's right, cute." We finally had to break the news, if there's anything that's right cute, doesn't mean it's that's right cute. We explained that neither right nor cute was the operative word. What Mrs. Nelson was actually seeking to convey was, that outfit makes you look like the side of a barn, if not the whole damned barn. The life of a Southern mother is bound by rules, which she, in turn, uses to make her daughters polite, but neurotic. We were going to allow the daughters of our friends to write chapters of this book, but when they started demanding equal time for their therapists, we thought better of the plan. The Southerner, incidentally, is ambivalent about shrinks. Many of us are stark raving mad, or at least crazier than a Betsy bug, though it's hard to differentiate us from all our wacko relatives. Even if Aunt Betty hears voices and prefers dressing in men's clothes, many Southern families will choose to ignore these minor eccentricities. Only vulgar people feel the need to face reality. Nice people pretend Aunt Betty was once in love with a man. Emily Potter Acock had not ventured out of her house for several years when the family doctor cautiously suggested that Mrs. Acock might benefit from the insights of a gentleman of the psychiatric profession. Her father, old man Potter, was insulted. Did the damned fool doctor think a Potter was crazy? Mr. Potter retaliated by paying his daughter's doctor's bill with a bag of nickels. No crazy folks here. Whenever a support group for DSMs, Daughters of Southern Mothers, gathers, we almost always discuss mother's rules. There are heartfelt signs of recognition. One rule concerns never uttering the word STINK. We know middle-aged DSMs who would rather run naked on Main Street than say STINK. Some of these DSMs could take the paint off the side of a barn with their curses, but they won't say STINK. Mother said it wasn't nice. Mother never told us not to use any of the really bad words. She didn't know them, thank God. But she did know the rules. Here are the key rules by which a Southern mother lives and which, in her role as preserver of culture, she instills in her daughter, no matter the psychic cost. Number 1. Never sit on the commode in a filling station. Always hover. Hovering is great for the legs. By the way, we say commode, not toilet. Number 2. Always wear a piece of good jewelry when going to the airport. That way people will know you are from a nice family. Why do we care? We just do. We secretly believe people might treat us nicer if they believe our rich daddy will horsewhip them if they don't. Number 3. Speak to all the chaperones. If you don't, mother will know because in the Delta there are no secrets. Number 4. Don't tell me. I don't want to know. Number 5. Tell me everything. I'm your mother. We will reveal some of mother's tricks for pumping the truth out of unsuspecting daughters in subsequent chapters. Number 6. Always be nice to other girls. They'll help you to get to the boys. Number 7. Always wear nice underwear. You may be killed in a car wreck, and you don't want the EMS workers to take one look at your poor dead little body and say, "Well, she certainly wasn't a lady." That would be a fate worse than death. Number 8. You can date him, but you don't have to marry him. Number 9. It is as easy to feed a good dog as a bad dog. Number 10. Never reply to a formal invitation in blue ink. and the Southern mother's all-time favorite rule of life. Number 11, serve left, retrieve right. The Southern matriarch is bound by genetic makeup to pass along these rules. She cannot help herself. Her mother before her did this to her, and her daughters will one day do it to their own daughters. For hundreds of years, no Southern child has been allowed to consume a morsel of food in peace. Little boats go out to sea. The matriarch will sing-song meaningfully if precious isn't eaten bouillon, a favorite matriarch treat, correctly. I'll bet the other little girls aren't rude to adults, mother will say, fully expecting that this will pacify the most recalcitrant three-year-old. The Southern mother believes that on Judgment Day he will ask, did your children stand up whenever an older person entered the room? She is rarely troubled by theological nuances, but sometimes finds herself pondering, did the 12 apostles have good table manners? I'm not sure if God cares if you write thank you notes with a ballpoint pen, one matriarch confessed in a rare moment of doubt, but I know I do. Our children might go to jail, our friend Grace observed, but it won't be quite as bad if they have nice manners and are sweet to the warden. We are told that this is not a sentiment widely embraced by mothers in other parts of the country. Another interesting attribute of the Southern mother is that she does not have bodily parts, and she is determined that her daughters won't either. Or, at the very least, we won't know what to call them. I remember one very clear rule, says Melinda Baskin-Hudson, daughter of Greenville's beloved Sally Baskin. Never refer to your own body part with the same vocabulary that is used for livestock. Belly comes to mind. Goodness, what a common word. It is a miracle that DSMs are able to tell the doctor what hurts. When Alice Hunt's mother was forced to go to work after her second divorce, she got a job at the House of Fashion, not necessarily the ideal place for a lady who didn't know the names of the parts of the human body. She had, after all, withheld the facts of life from her daughters through delicacy or ignorance, we aren't sure which. When it came time for her to reveal to her 14-year-old daughter that a baby sibling was winging its way to Earth, she had not exactly done the groundwork. Does Henry know? The perplexed teenager asked. Henry was her stepfather, Mrs. Hunt's then husband. Mrs. Hunt paused and cleverly pretended to ruminate for a few minutes. Why, yes, she finally said brightly, as if she had just recalled something fascinating. I believe I did mention it to Henry. Mrs. Hunt came running from a dressing room one day as if she had been shot, but it was worse. She had been hit by something a Southern lady detests far more than speeding bullets, which, truth to tell, she sort of likes. Vulgar language. A customer, obviously not the daughter of a nice mother, had used a slang word to describe part of her body. I refuse to be a part of this, Mrs. Hunt sobbed. She threatened to quit her job even if starvation loomed. It was several days before we realized she had no idea what the word meant, but she said it sounded bad. By that time, Mrs. Hunt was so thoroughly shocked by her racy new co-workers that wild horses could not have dragged her from the House of Fashion. She also knew that she could hold her head high. She would not have liked to have been called tough, but she was. That is the paradox of the Southern mother. Behind every magnolia facade is a will of steel. It should be noted that the Southern mother's love of indirect language extends far beyond unmentionable parts of the human body and into all realms of life. My mother, as were most of our mothers, was a master of the euphemism, recalls Melinda Hudson. We don't need to go into that, is the Southern mother's response to any unpleasantness. Long before the 12-step programs had popularized the concept of denial, the Southern matriarch had elevated it to an art form. Out of sight, out of mind, these are words to live by. The Southern matriarch navigates the shoals of life, not seeing anything of which she disapproves. If it is unpleasant, it doesn't exist. Somebody had a 10-pound preemie? Well, isn't modern medicine a marvel? Living in a constant state of denial takes a toll, but it also gives nice southern ladies a certain vagueness that is useful for their daughters, until they, too, mature and begin to find that it's better just not to know. We have a friend whose mother, Miss Janey, had a particularly awful experience in New Orleans. Miss Janey felt that it was the proper time to take her two daughters to see the Mardi Gras parades there. On the way to the Rex parade, Miss Janey got caught speeding. The policeman had the gall to insist on taking her into the police station, where she was fingerprinted, as her daughters gaped in horror at what was happening. Nice southern ladies do not get taken to the police station, exception the wild debutante who likes her toddy, though Miss Janey had to admit, being fingerprinted was sort of fun. All southern mothers adore being the center of attention, and nothing gets everybody's attention quite like being fingerprinted in a New Orleans jail. On the other hand, being fingerprinted is enough to remind even the vaguest Mississippi lady that she is being held at central lockup. Being arrested is not on any mother's top 10 list of genteel things to do. Miss Janey simply pretended it wasn't happening. She faced reality just long enough to call her New Orleans cousin, a lawyer who came down to the lockup to bail her out. When he said, "I'm here to get my relative out of jail," Miss Janey literally covered her ears. The cousin gallantly told her not to worry about a thing. She didn't. This turned out to be very bad advice. Summonses from the court in New Orleans began to arrive at her residence in Biloxi. Since Miss Janey didn't acknowledge that the unpleasantness in New Orleans had occurred, she stuffed each offensive new summons, soon arriving at an alarming rate, into her sewing basket. "What are you doing with the summonses I bring you, Miss Janey?" the sheriff asked. "Putting them in my sewing box," she replied primly, irritated at the sheriff's effrontery. Finally, the sheriff brought an arrest warrant instead of a summons. Miss Janey was driven downtown in a police car. After her husband arrived and quietly settled the mess, she had to admit her jailbird past, which was the first and last time the events in New Orleans were ever mentioned. From that day forward, Miss Janey never allowed anybody in the family to do so much as allude to Mardi Gras or New Orleans. Both had ceased to exist. We think we know what was going through Miss Janey's mind as Sheriff Akers drove her off in his squad car. What will the neighbors think? This is one of Mother's biggest concerns. When the brother of one of our friends became engaged to an overweight redneck, his mother's first thought was, of course, what will the neighbors think? She was also worried that the fat daughter-in-law would ruin a family portrait that was to be done in the spring. This mother has a very southern mother way of dealing with life's little vicissitudes. She barricades herself in the family's house on the lake until she has worked out a solution, which generally is just a matter of getting her story straight. Usually, the southern mother just gets out her scissors and snips plump daughters out of the family photographs, but that doesn't work so well with oil portraits. Fortunately, Mother was able to come up with a way out of this dicey situation. She persuaded the artist to change the appointment and paint the family a few months early. That way the fat daughter-in-law was not yet a member. The price was obscene, but well worth it. Another rule by which the southern matriarch lives: never learn how to do anything you don't want to do. We know a Leland, Mississippi grandmother who didn't want to cook or drive, so she didn't learn how to do either of these plebeian tasks. And grandmother was never late and didn't starve, her awestruck granddaughter recalls. Our friend Harper's mother loves tootling around town, but she has adamantly refused to learn how to drive in traffic. Mother doesn't do traffic, Harper explains. This turned out to be important when Harper's mother had to be evacuated from her house because of a hurricane. We told Mama to get her friends and pack her valuables, Harper recalled. She got her three friends and packed her valuables, the liquor cabinet and casseroles from the freezer. She was going to be somebody's house guest, and she needed to take house guest gifts, e.g. the casseroles. The liquor cabinet was for herself and her friends. Because of Mother's refusal to do traffic, she eschewed the highway, preferring to drive exclusively on pig trails in Texas. We think of Texans as Southerners who won their war for independence and have more money than we do. It made for a circuitous route. Mother also didn't do gas pumping. When the tank was low, Mother and her immaculately coiffed friends would find their way to a small-town gas station and get out of the car to stand near the pump. What Galahad might come along and fill our gas tank? Eventually, a stranger would fill the tank and do the credit card for them. Identity theft was never a problem. The Galahad always assumed that the ladies were on some retirement residence's most wanted list. Sometimes the Galahad cursed under his breath, which didn't matter, because southern matriarchs refused to hear bad language. Mother and her friends would then leave town and continue on dirt roads and shortcuts. However, to reach their destination, they eventually needed to cross a four-lane interstate. Because of the evacuation, a nice policeman was there to conduct traffic. Mother explained to the policeman that if he just stopped traffic, they could get across, Harper said. He refused, but then Mother sweetly explained that her three friends, all little old ladies, might have heart attacks if he didn't. Would he like to have that on his conscience? As horns were honked angrily, the defeated policeman stopped traffic and let them cross. It took Mother and her friends 3.5 hours to make what is generally a much longer journey. They were to stay with the son of a cousin of a friend of a friend. "I think your guests are here," their host's secretary announced. "Oh, no," he said. "They won't be here for hours." "Well," she said, "I see 4 little old ladies driving around the town square in circles. They stayed at his house for 3 days, playing bridge and consuming the contents of the liquor cabinet Mother had so perspicuously brought. Harper dutifully called each day. "Oh, they can't come to the phone. A bridge game is in progress," she was told the first day. "I'm sorry, but they're out having their hair and nails done," she was told the second. The next day, they were hosting a cocktail party. After 3 days, they felt they had to move on because they had run out of house guest gifts and liquor. As Mother's schedule of activities for day 2 indicates, the Southern Matriarch cares intensely about how she looks, even if she happens to be an evacuee. When one Greenville mother emerged from a complicated back operation, a potentially fatal one, she was asked by her sister-in-law, "Can I get you anything?" "A manicure would be nice," she sighed weakly. Monogramming is an essential element of home and self-beautification. The Southern mother will monogram anything that doesn't fight back. Sometimes she must force herself to stop before she gets to her toddler's eyelet underpanties. One reason the competition to be a cheerleader is so intense is that the cheerleaders get their names on their bloomers, the next best thing to a monogram. "I'm going to embroider rose petals on your panties," is the Southern mother's way of elaborating on one of her most important maxims, down in front. We know DSMs in middle age who never sit on porch steps, but that Mother's ghost doesn't drive serenely past, waving and making her trademark down-in-front motion. Unlike her counterparts from other parts of the country, the DSM arrives at school with everything needed for the all-matching dorm room. Color-coordinated sheets, towels, and bedspread. Mama herself is monogrammed to the pillow shams, which contrast strongly with the DYM's daughter of Yankee mother, Army-Navy blanket. "Give the Southern mother a theme and she runs with it," said a DSM who shudders at the memory of her all-pink dorm room. When the daughter of a Southern mother is exposed to the daughters of mothers from other parts of the country, she is likely to experience culture shock. "Mother!" more than one stunned Delta girl has wailed upon settling into her dorm room. "I just don't know what to make of my roommate. She didn't even bring a dust ruffle." There is one accoutrement the Southern mother neglects, the reading lamp. You can go blind trying to read in a Southern girl's dorm room. Higher education has never been a Southern mother priority, at least not like homecoming maid queen, Chi Omega, and or cheerleading. As we have noted elsewhere, the Southern mother's trifecta is cheerleading, sorority, and marriage. Note, Phi Beta Kappa didn't make the list. It's not a real sorority. If a Southern mother comes across her daughter with her nose in a book, she is likely to say something like, "Since you aren't doing anything, why don't you fix me a glass of ice water?" When the southern daughter puts her book aside to fix the ice water, she will be barraged with instructions. The southern mother wants her to fix the glass of ice water correctly. Take one of my crystal tumblers, add about 3 cubes of ice, she might say helpfully. Beset with such instructions, our friend Dabney erupted. Mother, I might not be as great a cook as you, but I can damn well make ice water. But Dabney, Mother said, this is an old family recipe. For all the hard work of instilling correct values, a southern mother expects undiluted homage. You must never write Merry Christmas to Mama, Love, Irma, Jane on a southern mother's Christmas present. Instead, you write Merry Christmas to the most wonderful mother in the world, who has sacrificed her entire life every minute of the day for me, and who is also the most beautiful mother in Greenville. You are a saint. All my love forever and ever, your devoted daughter, Irma Jane. When archaeologists dig up the Christmas gift tags of southern families, they are likely to think we are all incestuous, and not just Gramps and Granny, who were double first cousins. Our friend Alice Hunt adored her mother, but when her mother died, Alice had to finish an assignment in New York that delayed her mother's funeral 2 days. I'm sure your mother would have wanted you to do this, said an unknowing associate. Then you don't know my mother, Alice replied. She explained that Mama would want her to throw herself on a funeral pyre if the Greenville Cemetery had funeral pyres. It would be perfectly all right, of course, if somebody rescued Alice from the licking flames at the very last.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.